I will thank the EHF Handball Federation for being here. It's a big pleasure to try to tell you about some of my experience, and of course I have to send a special thanks to Lars Michalczyk, because he has been so persistent and pushing me in this direction since August this year. What I will talk about is, as I stand up there, rehabilitation, prevention, and physical training by means of beach handball exercises. So the first, I think I'll just talk a little about myself, because as you see it, the last thing is, it's a question of being in this game for, over 10 years. But I'm an educated physiotherapist. I have a master in the University of Copenhagen, a lecturer in anatomy. I'm a physical, and I have been a physical therapist for the female Danish beach handball team, national team, since 2007. And now I stand here with 10 years of experience in rehabilitation and prevention training in beach handball at different levels, as I will show you through this. First, a little about beach handball. You have heard a little about it these 2 days, and for me, it's a very exciting game. As I said, I've been in it since 1999, and I think it's a good alternative to the indoor game. And as I have written up there, it's, I see it as a popular game, an alternative game to the indoor, but I still meet coaches who think there's a big potential risk for playing beach handball. But now we know from data that it's not so risky. I'm looking forward to read the article when it comes. And I'll try to turn it a little around and look at training in sand in a positive way. There's a lot of studies from other sports that shows that training in sand can have a positive effect on both the performance and also the prevention. There's not so much in beach handball, but I've been doing quite a lot, and I have no scientific studies, but I have a lot of experience, and that's what I'm trying to lean on now. I believe that if you work in sand on the instable surface, you can facilitate motor learning, giving the player more moving variables. And we can talk about if that's good for playing indoor. I believe so as a physiotherapist. Also, I believe that I can start rehabilitation earlier running in sand, because it has this lower deceleration force. As you see, when you push your foot in the sand, you decelerate a little slower than you do in the hardcore. Yes. The unstable surface, as dry beach sand has, creates these more variables when you train. And if you look at the injury prevention training surface as an injury prevention training surface, I believe that these strategies, motor strategies, as you see in variables, when you push your foot in the sand, you have to gain balance again. And I believe that it activates the muscle strategies in a lot of different ways and challenge them to the limit. We're talking about balance, but also about postural control and motor learning. When you move in sand, I also believe, as I said before, that moving in sand with these high absorptive qualities, you can start early with the rehabilitation, because running in sand is not so hard as it is running at the indoor court. And another thing, as you can see on this picture, the sand stops movement around the ankle, as this term, and therefore we can minimize the twist in the ankle joint. When I'm training my players, playing young players, I use this interactive subsystem about postural control and use it in motor learning. And what I'm focused on when I'm doing this is the quality in movement. And the quality in movement is something subjective, because it's me when I'm looking at it as a physiotherapist. The other thing is I don't want them to use, when they're moving in sand, they can do some movements that's not so correctly, and I have to be there to give them this feedback. And if you just take the next, I've just taken a few things out of this dynamic system theory. First of all, the neuromuscular synergies is about kinetic chains, coordination. When you look at this, how to move in a good quality. And take another one out, the sensory strategies, it's the feedback. It could be intrinsic feedback from the proprioceptive and the exteroceptive senses, and it could be eccentric from me when I'm looking at it and changing a little bit. And then the anticipation mechanism, that's for me very important, because when you move in sand, you can't anticipate the next move because the sand is soft and it always varies. So the feet forward is always challenged here. So there's, of course, all the other things that has an impact on balance and control and motor learning and motor skills. But now I've just taken these few outs. Yes. I'll just show you. Do I have some? Yes. I'll just show you these two videos. If you point the first one, that's lunges. If you look at these guys doing these lunges, the first guy in the front is doing it all right, but this man or this guy, he's 15 years old. He's now 2 meters and 5 centimeters. There, he's around 192 or 193 centimeters. He's, as I said, 15 years old. If you look at the way he moved, if you can point it again, look at his hip, how he just fall out. And that's a strategy. He's trying to move in the correct way, but the challenge in the sand challenges his ankle, of course, and it challenges his knee and his hip. So the big question here is the challenge in the sand here has an effect on the way he moves in the knee, and he doing something with his knee to be in balance. There we talk about this feedback mechanism, and maybe it's here he needs some control, maybe it's here, but it affects his knee. And as I will tell you later, it's the hamstrings, as someone, some studies show, is very important to prevent knee injuries. Take the other video over there. Now it's progressed. It's still a lunge, but now it's with the jump. It's much difficult for these guys when they land. And that's another part of this. When you land on something that you're not so familiar with, you usually stretch your leg, because that's the way not to, to prevent something risky. I would like them, when they land, to bend their knee. So that was what we were training when they're doing this. But I put a launch on it, and then they jumped and land. Again, it was my feedback, and of course, the intrinsic feedback from them afterwards. The next video. Kettlebell swings has been shown to have a good effect on the training of the semitendinosus and the rate between the bicep femoris and the semitendinosus, the middle and the lateral hamstrings. When I use kettlebells in the sand, it's, as I has written up here, it's an exercise where the balance and the coordination, as you saw in the subsystems, are challenged. And when you combine it with this, maybe it has an effect. I have to say maybe, because I don't know. If you turn the next to next, I've got two videos here. It's not a normal kettlebell. I didn't have a video on the normal kettlebell, but we were using the kettlebell to look at some exercises, again, challenging the ankle and the knee and the hip. And here, it's also challenging the core. If you take the first one, if you look at the quality, it's not so good, but he's challenged, and he's challenged to the limit. And looking in another one here, he lost his balance. And you look at his ankle again, working in down in the sand. And the tibial ends here, and the posterior, and the peroneus is challenged here. If you take the other video, it's a thruster. Now it's moving in a kinetic chain, looking at, again, at the quality from the ankle up to straight. Yes. Again, there's a challenge in the under extremities. The next video, that was the things that I just shown you there is prevention and rehabilitation. And of course, in a progressed way, and you can regress the activities. Another way to train in sand is could be the cardiovascular training, because as you know, when you move in sand, it's two steps forward and one step backwards. And studies have shown there's energy cost in running in sand. I haven't taken any training sessions with me, but I have to focus on this, DOMS, delayed onset muscle soreness, because when you have been training in sand and training otherwise, somewhere else, the DOMS is indicate that you've been training. And the DOMS is falling here, so they can train with a higher intensity more often. Maybe, I don't know. Yes, I'll just skip this because I'm talking too much. I'm going to agility, because we have been talking about agility training in these sessions. And sand, again, as I see it, is a demanding surface to running. And if you work with exercises in sand, you'll be challenged when you change in direction, because as you show this video, you can see when he changed directions, when he pushed his foot down, it just moves. So when he pushes it, he don't get this fast speed, but he's challenging his ankle, knee, and hip in a greater variation. And maybe that will be good, I don't know. But if you take the next slide, there's been a study, as I have been written over here, 10 weeks in sand agility training has shown that it's been improved by a T-test indoor. So something good is it when you train in sand. But I don't know what it is. And as I said, written down here, it could be there's something that creates this positive effect on the takeoff phase. And as I have written down here, it could be due to the increased muscle activity which needed to stabilize the interval joints. Maybe it is. I don't know. It could be fun to see if it is. And if you show this video, yes. That's another part of this agility running in sand. And the last slide. Training in soft beach sand maybe have a positive effect on the rehabilitation prevention and the physical training. And I said may, because I don't know. All that you've heard just now is religion to me, because it's faith. I don't have scientific evidence to prove it, but I've written these three questions because balance and challenge, balance is challenged in sand, no doubt about that. But can this be transferred to the indoor activities? Could be fun to see. And would it be a good alternative to run in soft beach sand early in the pre-season period due to this faster restitution? And the last one, and do agility training in sand have a positive effect on the calf muscle and the Achilles tendon? Maybe It's studies that only I've seen. I've got some experience in this because I've seen my players move much better indoor after they've been training in sand. But I don't know if it's sand. It could be the same way if they've been trained indoor. My players is playing very offensive defense just now. Good to change direction. They've been training sand from the May this year and to August the 1st. But I don't know if it's the training in sand that's doing it. But the last but not least, we don't have had any injuries training in sand. So actually, that's a good thing. And the last slide. Thank you for listening. It's. Mm-hmm.